It don't matter. Come on, come on, y'all come sing. Everybody, everybody. See how full we can get it. Gracious, I like that. I like that full choir. So, would you stand with us, please? Number 310 in your favorite hymns of praise. There's two hymnals back there. Number 310. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Amen. You may be seated. Number four.
I think of all my faults and I fail. I Amen, amen. Well, we appreciate you being here tonight. It's been a good meeting, hasn't it? The Lord's really helped us. I appreciate God's help. He's been faithful, very faithful, as he always has been. And so I appreciate the Lord's faithfulness to help us tonight. Appreciate the good singing. I'm going to ask Jennifer and Jessica Reed's going to come sing for us. Then we're going to have Brother Gravely's going to preach for us tonight first. So you pray for Brother Gravely so he gets his self ready to come preach to us after they sing. And you just take your time, preacher. That's the burden of my heart. We need preaching in this day. There's just so many voices out there in these days to listen to. And there's no truth in a lot of it. And the only thing that's ever helped me in my Christian life is just the preaching of the Word of God. And there's just no substitute for that. So I don't want these men to feel like they're strained with their time, need to hurry or rush or anything. I want them to give us what God's given them. That's what I want. And so I pray that you... I was thinking that I can trust Jesus. Can you do that one? You pray for these ladies as they sing. Brother Bearden, you going to sit up here with me? I need you. What if I go off hook or something? He's going to hold me in line. That's what I needed him for. Hey, Brother Giddens, love you, preacher. Would you stand and pray again, brother? I really appreciate you, Lord, your church and you supporting us. Brother, we love you and appreciate your friendship, faithfulness to help us. And would you pray, brother, again? Pray for Brother Gravely, too. God, to use him to help us tonight.
Brushed off its wings and then watched it soar.
Yes, sir. Oh, yeah. Amen. Amen, young man. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. I laid me down and slept, and I wait. The Lord sustained me. It's one of my favorite verses in the Bible, because when you're at your most vulnerable, you didn't pray through it. You didn't give out enough tracts to get through it. You didn't witness enough through it. You didn't worship enough. You didn't shout enough. You didn't run enough. You did nothing. And there was a faithful Creator who watched over you when you were at your most vulnerable and weakest time. There's a God in the heaven that sustains you through the night. And you got up this morning because there's a faithful Creator that sustains you through the night. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. The only hope for you tonight, if you're unsaved, is Jesus Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen. I hope you're saved tonight. I don't know anything more important than that. And then you'll find a friend that'll stick with you, Brother Gideon, when you failed, when you're weak, when you're up, when you're down, don't matter what valley, what mountaintop, doesn't matter. It makes no difference to him. He is faithful that promised, and he will stick by you to the end. Distance and duration. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Don't care where you go. I don't care how long it takes. There'll always be God with you. You can count on it. Count on it. It's hallelujah. And as one man said, you can take that to the bank, as they say. So, amen. Brother Gravely, we love you, preacher. Appreciate your faithfulness to the Word of God and preaching, and we just appreciate you so much. I want you to come on, preach to us. Just mind God. I'm in no hurry. There's people tonight that'll be at a high school football game, and they'll be there at least 3 hours, minimum. So I think we ought to sit here until the football games are over. Listen to preaching. How about we just shout and worship God louder than they're shouting over a little old pigskin getting thrown up and down a field? There's a God in the heavens that lives inside of your mortal body, and he's going to carry you to a land that's fairer than day, where you'll never grow old, he said. Amen. Where there's no sickness, nor death, nor pain.
That's right.
Well, you know, I'm saved. I go to that fundamental church. You can't do nothing down there. Bless your little old heart. You got to live holy and live for Jesus. And he resisted striving against sin unto blood. Bless your little old heart. Can't even smoke cigarettes anymore. Them fundamentalists won't let you smoke cigarettes anymore. And preach on everything. Brother Gravely's going to preach here in a minute against pink shirts.
I did hear that one time. Hey, just preach. I love it. I love it. God help us. We need it, don't we? I'm sorry. I don't mean to be. I want to give these men time, but my heart should stir. I'm enjoying being a Christian. I wouldn't trade what I'm doing now. I'm like Brother Milton said this morning, Brother Madison. I wouldn't trade this for nothing in the world. Being an old-fashioned, old-timey Christian, I wouldn't trade it for nothing. I wouldn't trade 1 minute with Jesus for another 10 years back out in the world. I wouldn't trade none of it. He's been the dearest friend I've ever had. I've known more joy and more peace in the Holy Ghost. I've known more love, more satisfaction, more contentment in Christ in just a short period of time that I've known him than all the time I spent out in the world. He satisfied the deepest desires out of the overflow and needs nothing other than himself to meet the overflow, the deepest demands of your total nature. God doesn't need a car or flowers or gifts to make me happy. It's just himself. Blood pressure's 180 some over 117, and this ain't good for it, but hallelujah! I'm so glad to be saved, Brother Gilly. I don't know how people make it without God. I don't know how I make it without God, and I'm glad I'll never know again. I'd like to preach.
Go ahead.
No, I
have my time.
I love you.
Amen.
No, sir. Preach to us, brother.
Amen. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah for Jesus.
Amen.
I'm like these men said, I'm not recovering. I'm not apologizing. I am glad to be a King James Bible believing Christian, brother. I am not apologizing for nothing. I'm glad to be identified with these old-timey Christians. I am not apologizing for that.
Amen.
That's my family. That's the people that God brought me into his family. And I'd rather suffer afflictions with the people of us than that.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
I'm glad to be a part of this thing, buddy.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yep, man. Hallelujah.
I just thrilled with you.
Yep, man.
God saved me. God picked me up out of nowhere. I wasn't even looking for God. You're a Calvinist. That's what they'll call you. God's always speaking. I called on him because he called me. I found him because he found me. I love him because he loved me. God's always speaking. And when I said there wasn't even a God, God sent a preacher my way.
Hit me.
I'm excited about it.
That's right.
Have you got something real enough to put a little joy in you tonight? I wouldn't die and risk meeting God or some little old repeating something 1, 2, 3, 8, and C. I have the joy of the Holy Ghost in my soul. Don't sell yourself short tonight. God has got a salvation that's effectual to the enduring of the same suffering as we also suffer. He was talking about Paul. I don't know how I'm going to make it, Brother Ruth. I know how I'm going to make it. And he might show a pattern of long suffering to me. He shows Paul first. And he said, you've got a salvation that's just as effectual to endure the same sufferings as I
have. Yep. That's right.
5 pounds received out 40 stripes, save one. Shipwrecks, peril amongst the brother. I mean, he was in peril in the city. And Paul suffered. And we think, man, how did he get through? You've got in you tonight to endure just what he did.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
Hallelujah.
God.
Hallelujah. Yes. 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 Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen.
Go ahead, brother.
Amen. Well, you can tell he's been in camp meeting all week, can't you? That's the way it is when you're the pastor, moderator. You
you hear all this good preaching and you just feel hemmed up, amen. And kind of what they said about Lazarus is how I feel about moderators in camp meeting. You just sometimes, the only thing you can do is loose them and let them go, amen. And I tell you, we ought to all be like that. God's been good to us, amen. And I don't smoke cigarettes, but I sound like I do tonight. I tell you, I've been coughing. I don't have COVID. I want you to know that too. And I got some kind of little tickle in the back of my throat I've had all day. And that's what usually smokers say, though, isn't it? You know, so, I'm just glad to be in God's house. And I'm not going to be long at all tonight. Just give you what's on my heart and then get out of the way and let the man of God come. Looking forward to hearing him preach tonight. And it's just good to be where the Lord is at. Amen. And every time I come to this church, there's something that always stands in my mind. And I think about it every time I come here. And I just tell you what it is. It's the longevity of church membership. And you don't see that as much as you used to in a lot of places. But every time I come here, I look around and I see faces that have been here longer than I've been coming here. And I just thank God for people who will be faithful and just stay with the stuff and stay in the same church. Amen. I mean, if the church is preaching the truth and preaching what's right, and if it's not changed, then I don't think we ought to change. Amen. And thank God for people that are just faithful. And I appreciate your pastor, his spirit, and the desire and the burden that he has. And I pray that God gives you the desires of your heart this week as the meeting comes to an end. If you'll turn with us, Luke chapter 23, I know it's a familiar text, but it's what is on my heart tonight, and I'm not going to, and I know you preachers will know what I'm saying when I make this statement. I'm not preaching a message. I have a burden for what I'm going to preach tonight, but I'm not preaching a message that I feel like would require an invitation at the close of this message tonight. I think sometimes, you know, when you have two men of God preaching, God puts the burden on one to give that invitation, and the other one has its purpose in another form or fashion. And I just feel like this is the message God would have me to preach tonight, and I think it'll be a help to our hearts. It's a familiar text, but I think it's a needed subject tonight. If you'll stand with us in reverence to the Word of God in prayer, we'll read this passage of Scripture and pray, and then you can be seated. Verse number 39, Luke chapter 23 and verse 39. The Bible says, "And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due rewards of our deeds, but this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Heavenly Father, Lord, as we bow in your presence, Lord, once again tonight as we come to the throne of grace and mercy, we do come in Jesus' name. God, that name that is above every name. Lord, we realize tonight that without you there is no preaching, and that without you we can do nothing. God, I don't want to say or do anything tonight that would grieve the Holy Spirit in any way. But God, I pray that you'd be glorified. I pray that your Son would be magnified, and may the church be edified tonight. I ask you, dear Lord, to be pleased with our worship, and I pray, dear God, tonight that, Lord, we would see no man save Jesus only, and we'll thank you for what you do, for we do ask it in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen, amen. You can be seated tonight. Now, I know you've heard a lot of preaching on this text tonight. Every preacher has preached from Luke chapter 23. And when we think about these crosses here in our text, we're no stranger to the crosses that are on this hillside this day. We see these crosses, of course, as three different crosses. As we think about the man on the first cross in verse 39, we know that he is a dying sinner. And the man on the second cross, we know, is a dying saint. And then the man on the third cross in verse 43, the middle cross, he is a dying Savior, our dying Savior. We know that the man in verse 39 represents the cross of rejection, and the man in verse number 40 down to verse number 42 represents the cross of reception, proving that every sinner has a choice at Calvary to either reject or receive Christ. And then the man in verse 43 represents the cross of redemption. Amen. The man
man in verse 39 is dying in his sin, and the man in verse 40 down to 42 is dying to his sin, but the man in verse 43 is dying for sin. Amen. The man in verse 39 is a very hateful man, as we see him as he rails on the Son of God. The man in verse number 40 down to verse number 42, he's a very humble man, realizing that he is receiving the due rewards of his deeds. But the man in verse 43, he's a holy man, and he's a heavenly man. He's the Son of God. Amen. The man in verse number 39 represents a bitter cross. He's a man of no faith, as he uses the word if, as he says, if thou be the Son of God. You know, if he would have took that word, or the if thou be the Christ, if he'd have just took that little two-letter word out, he could have been saved. But that two-letter word shows that he had no faith in Calvary. He had no faith in the Christ of Calvary, and it sent him to hell. He's a man of no faith. He's a man of no fear, as he rails on the Son of God. And he's a man of no future. My friend, he's never mentioned again in the Scriptures. Just like every sinner that dies without God, he loses his identity and goes to hell. And so we see that he represents a bitter cross. And then the man in verse 40 down to verse number 42, he represents the believing cross. He had faith, and he believed in some things, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. And then the man in verse number 43, thank God, he represents the beloved cross. Amen. It was the cross in the middle that made the difference in my life and in yours. Amen. And so we think about these crosses as a whole. This man that hung on this cross in verse 43, the Bible tells us that he's a man of truth. As the first word out of his lips, out of his mouth in verse 43, is the word verily. Amen. And it means truly. He's a man of truth. He's a man of tenderness. As he said, I say unto thee. He's a man of today. You know, salvation is today. Amen. Today is the day of salvation. My friend, Jesus is not working in the past, and he's not working in the present. He's in the here and now. He's working right now in your life. And he is, my friend, a man of today. Hallelujah. He's a man of treasures. As he said, thou shalt be with me in paradise. The beloved cross, the bitter cross. But what about the believing cross? Oftentimes when we come to this text, and rightfully so, we focus on our Savior. But I want to focus on this man in verse number 40, because I'm interested in this thought about him. He started out on that Via Dolorosa just like the other thief did. The Bible says he cast the same saying. The thieves cast the same sayings in their teeth. They both started out as sinners. They both started out railing against the Son of God. But my friend, something happened to this thief. His theology began to change. He started out with Christ on the road to Calvary with his mind made one way and thinking one way. But the closer he got to Calvary, his theology began to change. Amen. You know, that's what Calvary will do to a sinner. If you never get them to the foot of the cross, Calvary will change the way we think. Amen. My friend, I can't change the heart and the mind of a sinner, neither can you. But if I can point them to the cross, if I can get them to Calvary, if I can get them to see the blood and see the Son of God, the cross makes a difference in our life. Amen. And so his theology changed. Now, the word theology simply means the study of God. Isn't that right? And I want to preach a few minutes tonight on this subject, on the theology of a thief. the theology of a thief, because I'm interested not just in what he believed, but how much he believed in the short time that he believed it, and what brought him to such a belief in such a matter of minutes. Amen. I'm telling you, it doesn't take long to get saved. Amen. It's immediate. It's instant. Amen. But here this thief started out believing nothing about God, but I'm telling you, by the time we get into this conversation here, he believes a lot about Christ. The theology of a thief. I want you to notice what he believed. Number one, I want you to see here what he believed about his maker. Amen. He said in verse number 40, but the other answering rebuked him, saying, dost not thou fear God? What did this thief believe about his maker? He believed two very important things. Number one, he believed that he was real. Amen. He said, dost not thou fear God? He believed God was real. I want to tell you tonight, I believe God's real. Amen. I believe God's as real as you'll let him be in your life. Amen. And I'm telling you, this world doesn't believe he's real, but God is real. Amen. 31 years ago, he became real to me. He became real in my soul. And can I tell you, for 31 years, he's been real every day of my life. I'm telling you, listen, it's good to go back to the day you got saved. But can I tell you something? I don't have to go back 31 years ago for God to be real to me. I'm telling you, it was real today. Amen. A lot of times people doubt their salvation, and the devil trips them up, and they can't figure out, did I really get saved way back yonder? Did I say the right things? And sometimes they say, preacher, I got saved at such a young age, and I just can't remember all the details. That doesn't bother me. I'll tell you, you don't have to try to go back and figure it out. You'll torment yourself to death doing that. If you're genuinely saved, guess what? There ought to be enough evidence in your life right here, right now, today. God ought to be real to you. Amen. I want to say he believed that his maker was real, and he believed that he ought to be reverenced. Dost not thou fear God? I'm going to tell you, I love him, but I fear him, don't you? And we ought to fear God. That's a problem in our country today. It's a problem in a lot of our churches today. There's no fear of God like there used to be. People live any old way, do any old thing. You know why? Because they don't fear the wrath and the judgment of God. I'm telling you, God's real, and God ought to be reverenced. Amen. They damn his name. They curse his son. They blaspheme my friend's church, and they carry right on. But I believe that our maker ought to be reverenced. Amen. Amen. He ought to be reverenced. What he believed about his maker. Secondly, I want you to see what he believed about mankind. What he believed about mankind. Notice what he said in verse number 40. Seeing that thou art in the same condemnation. Amen. He believed man was dying. Right. He could look at Jesus and tell Jesus was dying. Sure. Jesus died before both of these thieves. He watched Jesus die. Can you imagine that? Watching Jesus die. He believed mankind was dying. That's what he believed, my friend, about mankind. Not only that, but he believed that mankind was deserving. Look what he said in the next verse. He said in verse number 41, and we indeed justly, for we receive the due rewards of our deeds. Amen. He believed mankind was dying. Yes, sir. But he believed he was deserving. You know, if you get saved, you got to believe those same two things. You got to believe you're condemned to die physically and spiritually. You got to believe that you're condemned to die eternally in the lake of fire. There's three deaths. There's physical death, spiritual death, and eternal death. And you've got to believe that if you're going to get saved. Now, I didn't know all that the day I got saved. All I knew was I was dying and going to hell, and I sure didn't want to go there. Amen. I knew I deserved to go to hell. I knew that I could not save myself. He believed mankind was dying. He believed he was deserving. You know why we shout now? Because we still know we deserve to go to hell. But aren't you thankful for grace and mercy and love and salvation? He believed that mankind was dying. He believed he was deserving. He believed he was getting what was due unto him. Amen. You know, a sinner can't get saved until they get lost. Amen. And they're never going to get lost until they come to the realization, I deserve to go to hell. Amen. I deserve to die. Amen. That's what he believed about mankind. He was dying. He was deserving. And he believed that he was depraved. As he hung on that cross, there was a reality that came to his mind. He could not get himself down. He could not deliver himself. He could not save himself. He's pinned to a cross. He believed that he was depraved. That's what he believed about mankind. That's what he believed about his maker. I'm talking about the theology of this thing. Look at what he believed about his master. The master in verse 41. He said, but this man hath done nothing amiss. You know what he believed about his master here? He believed he was sinless. He hadn't done anything. He hadn't done anything. Oh, the crimes that they said he committed, the crimes that the religious crowd put on him, the crimes that the multitude were screaming at him, the closer he got to Calvary, by the time he got to the top of that brow and they hung him on that cross, he looked over at the Son of God and he may come to one conclusion, and it was this: he is sinless. Amen. He heard Pilate say, I find no fault in him. I don't know if he believed that starting out, but by the time he got to the top of Calvary's hill, he knew, listen, Pilate was right. He hadn't done anything wrong. He believed he was sinless. And can I tell you something? I believe he's sinless. Amen. I believe Jesus could not see it. I believe he did not see it. He is sinless. Hallelujah. He was born amongst sinners. As a child, he played with sinners. He grew up in a household of sinners. He worked with sinners. He went to the church. He went to church with sinners, and he preached to sinners, and he fed sinners, and he healed sinners, and he died among sinners, and he was a friend to sinners, and he ate with sinners. But the greatest thing about our Lord is that he was not a sinner. Hallelujah. He that knew no sin became sin for us. That means he not only died for me, and he not only died for you, but he died as me. And he died as you. He believed that he was sinless. That's what he believed about his master. And then he believed he was sovereign. Look at the next phrase. And he said unto Jesus, and you ought to circle this word, Lord. You know that's interesting? Because the only person that ever called Jesus Lord while he was on the cross was this thief. He believed he was sovereign. Amen. He believed that even though things were out of control, he still believed Jesus was in control. Amen. He believed that even though he was hanging on the cross, and I want to tell you something, even in the midst of Calvary, when it looked like the devil was winning, and it looked like, my friend, God was losing, and it looked like hell was in charge, and heaven was on the run, that couldn't be further from the truth. That's the biggest lie you could ever believe. I want to tell you something, God is so sovereign, and I'm not a Calvinist, amen, but he is so sovereign that even in the darkest hours of Calvary, he was still in control. Hallelujah. He was in control. I want to say tonight, he believed he was sovereign. I'm not a Calvinist. That got me in trouble a few weeks ago in one place. But I say it without apology. I am not a Calvinist. But I believe in the sovereignty, the providential hand of God. I don't believe things happen by chance or circumstance. Calvary wasn't an accident. It wasn't an afterthought in the mind of God. Oh no, it was before the foundations of the world, because he's before the foundation of the world. God is not in time. Listen, we live in this three dimension, amen. Listen, we say we was, we are, and we will be. But God didn't tell Abraham that. He didn't say I was, or I am, or I will be, but he said I am. Hallelujah. He is good. So God dwells in eternity, and God sees the beginning from the end because he's sovereign. Amen. Isn't that right? And this is what he believed about his master. He believed he was Lord. Then what he believed about mercy. Look what he said. Lord, just two words. Remember me. Now that's mercy, isn't it? If Jesus remembers this thief, wouldn't you agree with me? That would have to be mercy. Amen. And for Jesus to remember me, or to remember you. You know what that is? That's mercy. And he remembers us every single day. That's why his mercies are new every morning. I'm going to tell you, just the fact that God still knows who you are today and where you're at today, and that God took time out of eternity to remember your address, your name, and even the hairs on your head today, for God to remember everything about us, that's mercy on top of mercy. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for mercy, because I need mercy. I'm telling you, justice called. Oh, but mercy answered. Hallelujah. I'll tell you what he believed about mercy in these verses. He believed, number one, it was possible. He said, remember. There's a lot for Jesus to remember. There was a lot of people around the cross, but this thief thought that, you know what? It's just possible that he might remember me. I want to tell you tonight, it is possible. Brother, I'm telling you, if God will remember me, I'll just go ahead and tell you, he'll remember you. That means there's mercy for me, and there's mercy for you, and there's mercy for the man that walks the streets tonight, and there's mercy for those who are lost. I'm telling you, the mercy of God is not run out tonight. It is possible. Hallelujah. And then he believed it was personal. Lord, I want you to remember me. Lord, remember me. I'm telling you, I'm glad God has a memory. And I'm glad that God remembers others. But I'm glad he remembers me tonight. That's what he believed about mercy. And then I see what he believed about majesty. He believed some things about majesty. You say, what do you mean, preacher? Well, he believed, number one, look at verse number 42. He believed Jesus was a king. He said, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom.
Amen.
Not a kingdom.
Right.
But when you go into your kingdom.
Amen.
I'm telling you, this thief believed some things about majesty.
Amen.
Brother Pierce, he believed Jesus was a king.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to tell you something else he believed about majesty. Not only was he a king, but he believed he had a kingdom. I mean, that's so simple, even people from Alabama can put that together, amen? I mean, if you're a king, you must have a kingdom. And he believed that Jesus was a king. He believed that Jesus had a kingdom. He said, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. That tells me not only did he believe Jesus was a king and that he had a kingdom, but he believed that his kingdom was beyond this world. Hallelujah. See, he knew Jesus was dying. And he knew he was leaving this world. And he knew he was going to another world. And he knew that in that world he was king. And that in that world where he was king, that he had a kingdom. And this is what else he believed. He believed he wanted to go with him. Can I tell you something tonight? I believe everything about majesty that he believes. I believe Jesus is king. I believe he's got a kingdom. I believe his kingdom's beyond this world. I believe he's went to that kingdom. You know what? Just like him, I want to go with him, don't you? I'm going to tell you, he's the king of the ages. He's the king of kings. He's the Lord of lords. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of hell. He's the king immortal. He's the king invisible. He's the king eternal. He is king. Hallelujah. Is it your king tonight? That's what he believed about majesty. I read this one day. And preacher, when I got through, I thought, here's the question. I'll give you this and be done. How could a man start out in Jerusalem carrying a cross through an angry mob with another thief and saying the same thing that everybody else is saying? And in just, I'm talking about in just a matter of moments, minutes, his whole theology changes. How is that even possible? I think the answer is in our text. Look at verse number 33. I think these are the things that led Jesus. I'm not preaching, I'm just giving them to you. I think these are the things that led this thief to come to the conclusion of the study of God. Number one, I think it was the torture of Jesus.
Look at verse 33. When they were come to the place which is called Calvary, notice this. There they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand, the other on the left. It's clear in verse 33, they crucified Jesus first. He watched Jesus get tortured at Calvary. You know as well as I do, Jesus went to Calvary, but at Calvary, he was crucified like no other man had ever been crucified. His visage was marred beyond recognition. But as our Lord got to the top of that brow, and as he laid that cross down, there was no struggle, there was no fight, there was no cursing that came forth out of his mouth. He never spoke any guile. He did not resist. As a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before her shears is dumb, he opened not his mouth. He laid his life down just like he said he would. He laid willingly down. And that old thief is standing there. And he's watching Jesus, the torture of Calvary. And then I think of the torture of Jesus. And then I think in verse 34, it was the temperament of Jesus. They raised the cross. Our Lord is hanging on the cross now. No doubt they're getting ready to crucify these thieves during this process as Jesus is hanging there. Maybe it's him, maybe it's the other one. I don't know which one it is. But while they're crucifying the other one, Jesus cries out, Father, forgive them.
Yes.
Now, I don't know about you, but if I was that thief standing there and I saw, preacher, Jesus crucified and never spoke a word. And now he's on the cross, and I'm standing there, and I hear him pray, Father, forgive them.
Amen.
You know what would run through my mind? If he is willing to forgive them, then just maybe he's willing to forgive me.
Amen.
When he saw the temperament of Jesus,
amen, preacher.
Calvary's all about the forgiveness of God to sinners. I think it was the temperament of Jesus. I think it was the taunting of Jesus in verse 35. The people stood beholding, and the rulers also with him derided him, saving. Notice what they said. The first thing they said, he saved others. He's standing there. He sees Jesus crucified. He hears him pray for the forgiveness of others. Now he hears the crowd as they cry out, he saved others.
Right.
He may have thought to himself, he's forgave others. He even saved others.
Amen.
And if he saved others, just maybe, he might save me.
Amen.
You know why you're sitting here tonight? Because somewhere along life's way, somebody told you about him saving others. That's why you're here tonight. Somebody preached it to you. Somebody gave you a tract. Somebody witnessed. Somebody went to your doorstep. As a 10-year-old bus kid lost without God, a Sunday school teacher knocked on our door one Saturday morning with two big old red and white candy canes and stood there. My daddy in a drunken stupor. My mom standing there. And we didn't know nothing about God, nothing about the Bible, nothing about church. But all of a sudden, for the first time, we started hearing about him saving others. Amen. It took about 3 years, but I'm telling you, after about 3 years riding that bus, I came to the conclusion I needed saving, and I could not save myself. And if he saved others, then just maybe he would save me. Hallelujah. That's right. The taunting of Jesus, they said, let him save himself if he be the Christ, chosen of God. If you want to know where the thief in verse 39 got what he said, you find it in verse 35. He just repeated what the crowd said. You know, repeating the crowd will get you in trouble every time.
Amen.
I think it was the taunting of Jesus, the temperament of Jesus, the torture of Jesus. And then I close with this thought. I think it was the truth about Jesus.
Amen.
Where did he learn he was a king? Where did he learn he had a kingdom? Look at verse 37. If thou be the king of the Jews, save thyself.
Amen.
He heard it. But more importantly, look at verse 38.
Yeah.
He read it.
Amen.
The Bible says in verse 38, this is the king of the Jews.
Amen.
That old thief's hanging on the cross. He saw Jesus get crucified.
Yeah.
He heard Jesus pray. Nobody prayed like Jesus prayed. He heard the crowd as they preached the gospel to him, his soul with contention that he saved others. He heard the soldier say, if you're the king. And then he looked up there and he read it. Faith cometh by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. You say a sinner wrote that verse. No, a spirit wrote that verse. He just used a sinner to pin it down. Amen. You say, that's the word of God. It's in there. Amen. He read it. This is the king of the Jews. He thought he's the king. He hadn't done anything wrong. He saved others. He forgave others. And it brought him to this final conclusion. I cannot save myself. I cannot help myself. And he looked over. And with just a few breaths left in his body, my friend Jesus, he cried out to him. He said, Lord, would you remember me?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you something. What I love about this, Brother Bearden, is this thief was the last companion that Jesus had in this world before he died. But I tell you what, he was the first companion he had when he got to the other side. And I can see that thief in my mind as he walks through the gates of paradise, and the Lord is standing there to meet him.
Amen.
And the great gulf that separated him. I don't know what he thought, but he had to think this. I should have been going through them gates. Well, just a few moments ago, on my way to Calvary, I was headed there. But because of the man in the middle, because of the cross, just a few breaths away from hell, just a few heartbeats away from hell, I should be over there. But because of Calvary, I'm over here. I'm in paradise. I want to tell you, I ought to be in hell. I should go to hell. I was on my way to hell. But because of Calvary, thank God, I'm going to paradise. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Thank God for the cross tonight. This old thief, I don't know how much you can, I don't have any confidence in tradition. Tradition, though, says his name was Didymus, which means the sun is setting. I don't know how they could figure that out. It probably... more likely it wouldn't be true to me than it would be. But I will tell you one thing, whether it was or not, the sun didn't set in his life. The sun rose. I don't think his mentality changed one bit until he got to the top of that brow. And I want to tell you, friend, your mind will never change until you get to the foot of the old rugged cross. God bless you, brother.
You can stand to your feet. Well, you heard Jesus preached. If you're not saved tonight, be a good time to get saved, wouldn't it? It troubles me that you may not be troubled about eternity. But if you get a look at Jesus, you will be. Because when God measures you up, there's not some church hypocrite on the other side of the scale. It'll be the righteous, holy Son of God. And accept your righteousness. Exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees. The only hope you have, if you can't, Billy Mitchell, you say, if you can't produce it, is to get in one and produce it for you. And the only way for you to be righteous is to get in Jesus, have it imputed to you. So if you're unsaved, you can't save yourself. If you want to be saved, you come to Jesus. Repent and believe on him. The altars will be open. Brother Piercy's going to play a verse. If you need to come, you come on. Sing something for us, Brother Piercy, would you?
Lost and so lonely, just a sinner was I. no, had no future, wasn't ready to die. But I met the Savior, what a friend, just to know he took me to Calvary, washed me whiter than snow. Now I'm saved, yes, I'm saved by his marvelous grace. Child of that heavenly place. My heart's full of gladness, and my life, it's all aglow. For he took me to Calvary.
Amen.
Wash
Amen.
Me whiter. I don't have much money or this world's noted fame, but there's one thing that's for certain. Jesus knows me by my name. And although I was nothing, now to heaven I will go, for he took me to Calvary, washed me whiter than snow. And now I'm saved, yes, I'm saved by his marvelous grace.
Amen.
I am a child of that heavenly place. Now my heart, it's full of gladness, and my life is all aglow, for he took me to Calvary.
Amen. Amen.
Wash me whiter than snow.
Amen. 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 All right, you can be seated if you just be seated. Well, I appreciate the good preaching, Brother Gravely. Just exalting Christ, that's what we need in these days, just lifting up Jesus. And so I appreciate in those verses, Brother Giddens, so much. Aren't you glad how, you know what I mean when I say this, how simple it was. Salvation in our day, the waters have been so muddy. I don't know if sinners have any idea how to get saved anymore. It's been so, I'm not going to use convoluted. I don't even know how to spell it, so I generally don't use words I can't spell, but. Aren't you glad he said, remember me, and he said, today.
Amen.
It's difficult to turn on yourself, but to agree with God against yourself, that may be a difficult process at times. The flesh won't die easy. But when it comes to getting saved, you believe on Christ Jesus, and he'll save you. And it's not hard for him to save you. He came to save sinners, didn't he? Well, I'm excited. Brother Massengill's here with us. I appreciate him being willing to come. He's a good friend of Brother Jones, and I appreciate him being willing to come preach to us tonight. I want him to come on and preach. You pray, and you pray for the man of God. God will use him to speak to us from the Bible tonight. Brother, why don't you, Brother Willis, would you pray? Why don't you pray for the man of God and see he stands to preach again?
Amen. Well, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Thank God for the preaching. That was a great message. Praise God. The Lord's fed my soul today. Amen. Thank God for all the messages that was preached last night and today as well. Truly, it's been a blessing to us, and we thank the Lord for it. Amen. It's been a long time since I've been here, but some familiar faces still here. Amen. And we praise the Lord for that. Amen. It's good to see Brother Jones. He's supposed to be with us in December. We'd had him scheduled several times, and then things that happened with all that's been going on around the country with sickness and Miss Sandra having some accidents, but they're supposed to be with us in December. So praise the Lord for his friendship and the impact that he has had on my life and on the life of my family, as well as this church and its ministry in days gone by. Amen. But we appreciate the Lord and the goodness of God. And it's an honor to be invited and to be here. Thank you so much for the fine room, the basket. My wife was not able to come with me. She was planning to. We had gone to South Carolina. We had my mother-in-law with us for a while, and she's 90 years old. And she's having some complicated issues right now, and so she was not able to leave her, so I've got to go back south, Lord willing, in the morning. But I know she misses being here, but we thank you for the good meal today, and the hospitality is second to none. Appreciate the goodness of the Lord. I want you to take your Bible for just a moment for us this evening and go to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms in chapter number 45. Trying to find the mind of the Lord to preach is a difficult thing for me. I'm a pastor, I'm not an evangelist, and I don't live in an area like this as far as good churches and preachers and meetings that you can just drive a little ways and attend. It's a 2 hour to 2.5 hour drive from where I'm at to any church or church meeting that would believe what we would believe and stand where we stand. And so, I don't get out a lot, and I don't preach many things twice. There's several reasons. Number one, I don't get out a lot. Number two, my notes don't make absolutely any sense to me after I've preached it one time. I pull them out and I think, I'm going to preach this message. And I look at what I thought, that makes no sense at all to me. And so that's kind of where I'm at with it. Amen. But I'm glad, thank God, to be able to be here and appreciate, amen, again, the friendship of this church. I heard a story. There's a fellow in Tennessee. He got an idea. He's going to dig a hole to see what he could find. He dug a hole 20 foot deep. He could run across a copper wire. And so he wrote this big article and said, because of what he discovered digging a hole 20 feet, that the state of Tennessee 200 years ago had a communication system. Well, as a fellow in Georgia felt kind of intimidated by it, so he thought he'd try the same thing. So he dug, didn't find nothing at 20 feet, dug on down to 30 feet, and sure enough, found him a copper wire. And he said, wrote an article and said he come to the conclusion that 300 years ago, the state of Georgia had a sophisticated communication system. Well, an old hillbilly from Kentucky heard about it, and he wasn't going to be outdone, so he started digging. Dug 20 feet, he didn't find a thing. Dug 30 feet, didn't find a thing. Dug 40 feet, wore out, didn't find a thing. So he just stopped digging and concluded that the state of Kentucky 400 years ago had already went wireless. Amen. Amen. That's something. Let's stand to our feet. Psalms chapter 45 tonight. It is good to be saved. Amen. Thank God for that preaching. Need you to follow along with me. We'll read these 17 verses. Try to be brief, but try to give you the burden of our heart. And so you try to follow along. Notice what's being said in these verses, and we'll try to move as quickly as we can. Verse 1, Psalms 45, my heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of the things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. Therefore God hath blessed thee forever. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O most mighty, with thy glory and thy majesty. And in thy majesty ride prosperously because of truth and meekness and righteousness, and thy right hand shall teach thee terrible things. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies, whereby the people fall under thee. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of thy kingdom, the scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. All thy garments smell of myrrh and alloys and cassia out of the ivory palaces whereby they have made thee glad. King's daughters were among thy honorable women. Upon thy right hand did stand the queen in gold of Ophir. Hearken, O daughter, and consider and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord, and worship thou him. And the daughter of Tyre shall be there with a gift. Even the rich among the people shall entreat thy favor. The king's daughter is all glorious within. Her clothing is of wrought gold. She shall be brought unto the king in raiment of needlework. The virgins, her companions that follow her, shall be brought unto thee. With gladness and rejoicing shall they be brought. They shall enter into the king's palace. Instead of thy father shall be thy children, whom thou mayest make princes in all the earth. I will make thy name to be remembered in all generations. Therefore shall the people praise thee forever and ever. You can be seated. Verse number one, the Bible said, my heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of the things which I have made touching the king. My pen, my tongue is the pen of a ready writer. These collection of psalms that are before us tonight are considered the prayer and the praise book of the nation of Israel. As you travel through the book of Psalms, it will transform your reading and transform the way you look at these poetic melodies if you will understand that while you travel through these books, you are walking down the road of human experience. Truth is revealed about every area of life through the circumstances that the people of God have passed through. As you read through the Psalms, you will hear the noise of battle. You will hear sounds of joy. Yet you will hear the weeping of a broken heart. You will read about the fury of anger. You will see questions of doubt and expressions of dismay. You will hear the silence of a hushed heart in the sanctuary before God's presence. Moans of imprisonment, captivity are heard. The anguish and the affliction that sin brings in the life of an individual are all manifested through the Psalms as you read the inspiration and the penman writing down how he feels within his soul, how his mind is thinking, and how his heart is stirred. Love, hate, joy, sorrow, hope, fear, peace, strife, faith, and despair. Every human emotion is bursting out with melody and rhyme. It contains the vast storehouse of human experience as you travel through the pages of the book of Psalms. It is a book of praise, a book of poetry, a book of precept, a book of prophecy, a book about people, a book of principle, a book, yes, with problems and perplexities, yet passion and purpose. It is a book of prayer where the people of God have went through life and struggles and trials and difficulties, and God has allowed them to pour their heart out unto us in melody and rhyme and in song. Whether we are looking back at history or looking up into the heavens, amen, or looking around at our problems in life, the heart of the poet blends with poetic word and a company of a musical instrument. Melody rings forth and bears his thoughts and the condition of his soul. I'm telling you, if you'll look at the book of Psalms and travel through it with those things running through your mind, God will let you see yourself, amen, as you
you read these verses and as God speaks to your heart about the situations and the difficulties and the struggles that you face in life, there's a word in this psalm that we would never use in our common conversation in life. It's found in verse number 1, and that word is the key word that I want to emphasize with the thought the Lord has dealt with our heart about tonight. My heart is indicting. Indicting. And that word basically means to be moved. It means to be stirred. It means to have something bubbling up or something going on within the bosom of your life. And I want to try, if I can, for just a moment tonight to preach with this thought in mind and that word before us on being moved. Being moved by what matters. Being moved by what matters. The psalmist said, my heart is indicting, it's moved, it's stirred a good matter. He didn't say in a good matter. He said, my heart is indicting a good matter. Being moved by what matters. We see in the opening of this psalm that it is a song of loves. It's about a marriage between two individuals. It was a song that was penned down to be sung at a wedding. Most scholars would tell us that this psalm would have been sang, or it would have been sung, if that's the right way of putting it grammatically. This song would have been performed at a wedding, most possibly in the king and the queen at their wedding day. Even though every human being is distinctly different, there is one thing that everybody in the world has in common, and that is emotional expression. No matter where you go, you can go in a jungle, you can go in the far reaches of some area in our world, and you will find a common denominator, amen, that is represented in those people's lives just like you. And it makes no difference what color their skin is, makes no difference what color, amen, they are, or what conversation they may speak. Their conformation may be different, their culture may be different, everything about their life may be different, but they all share one thing in common. They cry. Amen. They smile. Yeah. They laugh. Amen. They hurt. Yep. They grieve. Isn't that amazing? Amen. I was preaching at a prayer conference. Don't ask me how I got invited, but I was the night speaker at a prayer conference in Denver, Colorado, a number of years ago. Big meeting there, and everybody was a doctor, and I wouldn't even have made a good nurse, amen. And big high church environment, you know, more, you know, I'm from the South, the sophisticated singing, you know, classical stuff, and they got me preaching at night. I don't know if it was for a novelty or what, but I got to preaching, you know, and they're low-key, you know, no rejoicing, no noise pretty much, kind of straight-laced. And then I got to preaching about worship and about magnifying the Lord. I said, it makes no difference if you're in Denver, Colorado, or if you're in Michigan, or if you're in the deep South, amen. You look at one side of the field or the other side of the field, and they all act the same when somebody scores a touchdown. They all look the same. They all have the same expression. We just share that. And so things move us. Amen. Things happen in our life. The king here, amen, is represented in the first 9 verses, and the queen is represented in the latter verses. We understand that this is a maschil psalm. It is a psalm that should offer instruction to us, as well as it is messianic in verse 6 and 7. I'll not take time to go there, but I want us to be considerate tonight of the context of this entire psalm and think about what moves us. And does what move us? What stirs us? What does something for us? Does it really matter? Does it have any meaning to it? Is it have any lasting ability? Amen.
The matter at hand is love, and it's the love of a man for a woman. It is very easy for me to determine in your life what matters to you just in verse 1, and I need to hurry. But it's very easy for us to consider verse 1 and come to a direct conclusion of what really matters to us. Notice what he said, my heart is indicting in a good matter. So what matters to you is what's in your heart. Not only what's in your heart, he said, I speak of the things which I have made touching the king. Not only what's in your heart, but what other people hear from you. That's what matters to you. What you talk about all the time with your peers and those around you, what you speak about, what you converse about, what your conversation revolves around, amen, is expressing what's in your heart. Not only what you hear, what's in your heart, but what you make happen. Here's what he says, I have made touching the king. He said, the things which I have made touching the king. In other words, he said, I have made this matter. Amen. If fishing is what matters to you, that's all you want to talk about. It's in your heart. I'm not picking on folks that fish. I fish. Amen. I'm just using that as an analogy. That's all you want to talk about. Amen. It's in your heart, and your conversation revolves around it. And you're going to make that happen, aren't you? You're going to make plans. You're going to plug the boat up. You're going to get the bait. You're going to figure out where you're going to go. You're going to make that happen. You see, what matters to you is what you make happen and what you hasten to do. He said, amen, in the latter part of that, my tongue is the pen of a ready writer. He said, I'm telling you, what I'm about to talk to you about matters to me, and it moves me. And I'm going to tell you why it matters to me. It's in my heart, amen. Amen, it's what other people hear when I'm around them. Amen, it's what I hasten to do. It's what I make happen in my life. Amen. You have influence. You say, preacher, I'm a kid. I don't nobody look up to me. I don't have any bearing on anyone's life. You have influence, and the most powerful influence that you have in your life is not those around you, but the influence you have over you. Amen. You are in control of what's in your heart. You are in control about what others hear around you. You are in control of what you make happen in your life. You are in control of what you hasten to do. And if you can wrap your world around what this psalmist has wrapped his world around that mattered to him, and it could move you and it could stir you, you could influence your heart and your life, amen, to be stirred by something that's meaningful. So there's two things that the psalmist said that moved him, that mattered to him. The bridegroom and the bride. It's as simple as that. He said, I'm going to tell you what moves me as he pens this psalm. Amen. To be sung at the wedding of his king. Amen. I can imagine in my mind, amen, what it was like for him to sit down and start writing these words as his heart stirred within him. His king is about to marry. He's going to have a queen. Amen. And he says, I'm telling you, my heart is stirred. I am moved within my soul. And this really matters to me. And he begins to open up. Amen. This psalm with words about the bridegroom. Amen. The bridegroom matters. Can I say, as the songwriter said, amen, I don't know any better than Jesus tonight. Thank God. Thank God for the Lord Jesus. He is our bridegroom tonight. Amen. And the psalmist begins to write about his bridegroom. The Song of Solomon said he's altogether lovely. Amen. Paul said he ought to be highly exalted because he's given a name, amen, which is above every name, thank God. And I'm asking you tonight, does the bridegroom stir you? Does the bridegroom move you? Are you stirred within your soul, amen, when you think about who Jesus is?
In verse number 2, he says, the bridegroom matters. His grace matters to me. He says, thou art fairer than the children of men. Grace is poured into thy lips. Therefore, God hath blessed thee forever. I don't have time to read all these verses. You can read them, amen, again when you get home. But his grace matters. He speaks of the manhood of his grace. Isn't it amazing to think that God would condescend to this earth? Amen. Robe himself in flesh. Walk among sinful men. Be rejected of those men. And yet, amen, still knowing what would happen, would come to this sin-cursed world. Amen. It's a mystery, but it's a great mystery. Amen. God was manifest in the flesh. Amen. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was at the beginning with God. And the Bible said the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That is an amazing measure of the grace of God and the manhood of the grace of God. When Christ would come to this world and offer himself a sacrifice for the sins of mankind. Does that move you? Amen. Or if Tennessee's playing tomorrow, I've seen all the orange coming in the motel. But if you're going to be more excited, amen, watching Tennessee play tomorrow, or Georgia, or Kentucky, or whoever it is, if your heart is stirred, you get on the edge of your seat. If that matters to you more than this does, you got a problem tonight. But I'm telling you tonight, thank God the bridegroom matters to me. And I'm moved by his grace. As the preacher was preaching, my heart was stirred when he told me about the mercy of God in his life. Amen. When he talked about God saving him tonight, that stirred my soul. I wasn't the one he saved at that time. He was just telling me what was in his heart. He was just letting us hear what was in his soul. He seen something happen in his life, and he hastened to tell us, amen, that God in his mercy and grace reached down and saved. That stirred my heart. Amen. Thank God. There's something started bubbling up inside. Thank God.
Amen.
Talks about his lips. I can say to you tonight, the message of his grace mattered. Amen. Thank God for the story of the gospel. I'm anointed, he said, to preach the word of God, Jesus said. Amen. God's spirit was upon him. Amen. There's something about preaching. Amen. Amen. That just does something to your soul. You sit down. Man of God stands behind the pulpit, opens up the word of God. Just an ordinary man, just like you are, eats the same kind of food. Amen. Has to have the same things in life to sustain his physical existence. He opens up the word of God. He begins to read verses that holy man of God, moved by the Spirit of God, had pinned down, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, there's something gets on that man. Amen. It's hard to explain, amen, brother. But I said there's something gets on him. He gets to preaching, gets to high stepping. Amen. God moves on him. I'm telling you, the message of the gospel rings out in power, and souls are stirred, lives are changed, and the power of God. Amen. The message of his grace, the manifestation of his grace. Thank God it's real. This is not a fairy tale tonight I'm talking about. Praise God, this is real. It is the manifestation of the sovereign, holy grace of Almighty God. And it matters, thank God. And it ought to move everybody in this building tonight that God in his mercy would come to where you're at, reveal you a sinner, show you you're without God, and the bridegroom of heaven would reach out and draw you unto himself. Hallelujah, thank God, for the grace of God, the manifestation of that grace.
Bless the name of the Lord.
Great is thy faithfulness. Every day the mercies of the God of heaven are renewed in our lives.
the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah. That ought to matter to us tonight. That ought to matter to us tonight. It ought to move us, thank God. It ought to stir us within.
Amen. Amen.
The bridegroom. Praise God. His grace matters. His glory matters. Amen. In verse 3. Back it all like a handle. Amen. He said, gird on thy sword upon thy nose. Mighty, he said, with thy glory and thy majesty. Thank God the glory of our bridegroom matters. The glory of his might. Thank God I serve a Savior. Amen. Thank God that is powerful. That is strong. Amen. The world, amen, can't change a sinner. Amen. The world can't transform a life. But God Almighty, through the bridegroom, has the power to take a thief on the cross. Amen. And deliver his soul from sin and the power of iniquity and rescue him. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Men are moved by the power of God. As I was praying the other night, Isaiah, in the book of Isaiah, when Isaiah cried out to the Lord, he said, oh, that thou wouldest rend the heavens, that thou wouldest come down. And you read that chapter, he said, oh Lord, if you'll come down, these mountains that's overwhelming us, you'll move from, they'll melt down. All these men that are in the way, God's power can move them, amen. I'm going to tell you why we're seeing nothing done in this day. The bridegroom don't matter to us anymore. But I'm telling you, if we could have revival tonight of who he is and what he's done for us, and it would move our souls, strengthen our faith. Thank God we could see the hand of God move again. If the bridegroom, amen, would move our heart.
He's still on the throne.
Men of might, men of power, men of renown, amen, have moved people. Speeches. I remember being in the fifth grade at Victor Elementary School as a boy in Greer, South Carolina, where I'm from. And I remember Miss Kennedy was our teacher, and she played a clip from an old reel of Adolf Hitler speaking. And as a young boy in the fifth grade, Brother Boyer, I couldn't understand a man. I couldn't understand a word that man was saying. And I'm telling you, I sit there in awe at the authority and the satanic unction that was on that man. I mean, it moved me. I don't know how to explain it, but it moved me. Amen. Donald Trump, even though he's not our president tonight, would come somewhere in the state of Tennessee, and they announced in 30 minutes that he was going to be speaking. There would be untold thousands of people gather in a moment of time. But days pass. Hours, days, months, years. Are you listening? And those men that moved others, they really didn't matter. What I said about Adolf Hitler tonight, you hadn't thought about him all day, have you? Hadn't even considered him. Amen. But he moved a nation. Amen. But Jesus still matters to me. Oh, those men had a lot of glory and a lot of majesty and affected a lot of people. Amen. Amen. But it's been over 2,000 years. That's a long time. Amen. That's a long time. And tonight, here we are, amen, in Hammond, Tennessee, telling a story about a man, thank God, that lived over 2,000 years ago, and who he is and what he represents, amen, still moves men and still matters, thank God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah, thank God.
His glory matters.
The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth his handiwork. Verse after verse after verse I could read. We could talk about in these verses the glory of his might. We could talk about, amen, the glory that's manifested. The glory of his meekness, amen. All of that matters. His grace matters. You see, the bridegroom, his grace matters. The bridegroom, are you listening? His glory matters. The bridegroom tonight, I'm moved because his government matters. Look in verse 5. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies, whereby the people fall under thee. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Amen. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. Amen. His government matters. I ain't too. I get stirred up about the government. I got a politician in my church. Amen. God help us. Amen. He's a good godly man. He directs our home. Brother Josh Calloway. Most of you know him. Plays our piano. And he is our state representative. And the corruption that is in just the state house of Kentucky is mind-boggling. You know that there's corruption until you have connection with someone that is intertwined in the policies and legislation of laws and how corrupt and ungodly and wicked it is. And it does stir me sometimes, but an indignant way it does. Amen. But I'm telling you, amen, when I begin to think about the government of the bridegroom, amen, that has joined me to himself, it matters to me. You could preach this tonight, but in verse 5, he governs his adversaries. Thine arrows are sharp in the heart of the king's enemies. Boy, that one verse right there could change America. Amen. If there was an authoritative man that would step in the White House of this nation, amen, and say, this is how it's going to be, and otherwise there's going to be blood in the streets, amen. I'm telling you, things would change in this nation and around the world. But there is coming a day, amen, when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is going to sit, amen, on the throne. I preached out of Psalms a number of years ago on when the King is on Capitol Hill, amen. Amen. Thank God there's coming a day. I'm looking forward to the rapture. Don't misunderstand me. I'm looking forward to the trumpet sounding and us being caught up together with our loved ones to meet the Lord in the air. But there is something that stirs within my soul when I think about the day, amen, when we come back with him, amen. Amen. This world hadn't seen the last of the church. We're leaving out of here, but we're coming back in an altogether different line. Amen. He's going to stand on the Mount of Olives. It'll cleave a thunder. He'll spread those wounded hands out. And they'll say, where did you get these wounds? And he says, in the house of my friends. But that day he'll say, peace be unto you. And there'll be peace on this earth like this earth has never known before. And he is going to sit on a throne, thank God, and rule in righteousness. And thank God we will rule with him. That matters to me. I had a man lived down the road from us in our county. He was a paratrooper. Now I bird hunted with him a lot, and name was Abe. Kind of a short fella, but pretty conditioned guy, an older man. He was in the paratroopers, and he said, preacher, he said, when I was in the paratroopers, they told us that we could whip any three ordinary men, any of them. He said, I never met an ordinary man in my life. I got whipped every time I got in a fight, he said. He said, that man lied to me. But he's a patriot. Loved this nation. Elected Bill Clinton into the White House. Now, I'm not kidding you, he cried every day of his life for 2 solid weeks. I'm not exaggerating. Flew his flag at half staff right in the middle of the front yard. I don't know how long he did that. He was tore all to pieces. It didn't take me that long to get over it. But I'm going to tell you something. Those kind of things move us. But I'm telling you, in the realm and sight and view of eternity and the kingdom of heaven, they really don't matter, do they?
And that ought to cause each one of us, no matter what's going on in the world that we're living in, thank God, to rise up each day of our life and let the bridegroom and who we're a part of matter to us and move our soul. Amen. He rules his adversary. He governs his adversaries. Let me say verse 6, he governs with authority. And let me say verse 7, he governs with anointing. Amen. That's going to be preached. I don't have time. But his grace matters. His glory matters. His government matters. His greatness matters in verse 5 and 6. And his gladness matters in verse 7. Thank God for the joy that the preacher preached about today. His garments matter in verse 8. All that could be preached. Moved, stirred, overjoyed by what I make, what I'm in control of, that matters to me. You are in control, young man, of what matters to you. Let me tell you about that elk I killed. I got pictures of it. Let me tell you about that deer I killed. Yeah. Let me tell you about, did y'all see the ball game? Did you see what happened in that fourth quarter? I mean, boy, y'all sitting there, man, laughing. And I mean, I remember sitting at the table with Brother Allen years and years ago in Sturgis, Kentucky. And I don't know what got to talking about fighting, but you ever got talking about boxing with Brother Allen, son? He stepped into another world. He said, I remember the thrill of Manila. He got to talking about it, son. And I mean, son, and then after he got through, he said, hey, man, me and the fellow was with us. We had to go in the motel and pray for 3 hours before we could get to church and get right with God. Amen. But things like that will move you. Things like that will matter to you, but you let it matter. You make it happen. It's in your heart. But I'm telling you, so you have control of that. You're in control of what matters. You'll get in that book, praise God, realize that there's a bridegroom, thank God, that the Lord sent to this earth, and you're the bride. Hallelujah, it'll matter to you. And it'll move you. Then the bride matters. We switch from the bridegroom to the bride. I got to quit. Lord, I'm wore out. If the bridegroom is the Lord Jesus, we know the bride is the church of the Lord Jesus. Does the church matter to you tonight? Does the church move you? I'm going to be away from my church this Sunday, my pastor celebrating his 80th birthday, and I forget how many years him and Miss Norma has been married, and 50 years of being in the ministry. And I have the unusual privilege of serving the Lord with all of my children. All of my children are a member of my church. I have 13 grandchildren. All of them are in church, and they're all coming down to be there tomorrow, and they've asked us to stay over for Sunday, Brother Rainey, to be preaching, so we've committed to do that. And I'm telling you, even though I want to honor the man of God,